nothing is not the end of the world. Okay, I'll try to do my best.
Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, colleagues, scholars from Poland and elsewhere. I'm very pleased to be here and very honored to open this conference on marking the 18th anniversary of the Aktion Reinhardt in Poland. And thank you, Martina, for the very warm introduction. I titled my speech today, "When Time Ends, a Cultural History Perspective on Jewish Life in Poland, 1943. And I will try to present a different perspective to some of you I might be new than anything you heard before on Jewish life in Poland before the deportation and during the deportation, from what we know as cultural history or cultural history perspective. For several years, research on influence of time, consciousness on human behavior has been a center of cultural history discourse. The historian Moshe Rosman explained that cultural history is not interested in the products of the individual or society's creative forces, but in the meaning they communicate. In other words, cultural history focuses on the meanings of cultural institutions, religion, science, and products, rather than their descriptions. The influential British historian Peter Brook defined cultural history as dealing with the symbolic and its interpretation. That is, the study of cultural history focuses on culture as a symbolic infrastructure that consolidates consciousness, reference to reality, an existential meaning rather than on cultural activity. In other words, the questions concerning what and how happened are secondary and important in cultural history. The main question that the cultural historian faces is how the historical participants understood what happened and how they gave meaning to themselves, their lives, and the reality in which they operated. Hence, cultural history is a field of research that touches on literature, sociology, anthropology, social psychology, gender studies, and many more. Are these questions relevant to the study of the Holocaust? Are they relevant to the life of Jews in Polish ghettos between 1940 and 1943, before they were evacuated to the extermination camps of Aktion Reinhardt? The Jewish intellectual Zelig Kalmanovich, one of the leaders of YIVO in Vilna before the war, wrote in his diary in the ghetto on July 26, 1942, and I quote, Last week, we invited to the commander, Yaakov Gens, the head of the Vilna ghetto, to look at the plan for the memorial monument to the ghetto. The people want to remain in history. They deserve it. Kalmanovich was writing these things after about two-thirds of Vilna's Jews had been exterminated during the first year of the German occupation in Lithuania. He understood the meaning of the end of history, but simultaneously, he had his heart set on the inevitable need to remain in history on the part of the Jews who continued to live and work in the ghetto. How do we understand the meaning of the end of time or end of history when the deportation and extermination posed an existential challenge to the Jews in Polish ghettos. In my work today, I wish to examine this existential interaction from the perspective of cultural history. One of the most challenging questions to deal with from the perspective of cultural history is this: understanding the encounter with the death as true of life, an attempt to understand the experience of living in a unit of time or in a cycle of time passed from life to death. However, it is essential to that, so that we can try to understand the essence and consciousness of Polish Jews in the last days or hours of their lives. What then is the cycle of time, and how can it be examined when studying the Holocaust in Poland? Moreover, how can we understand it in a context of the period of deportation for extermination? The founder of modern sociology, the French Emile Durkheim, stated at the end of the 19th century, if men did not have the same conception of time, all contact between their minds would be impossible, and with that, all life together. The famous Indian sociologist and anthropologist, Radhakamal Mukherjee, also defines the centrality of time to a society's ability to exist. Social adaptation requires that time should not be the unreliable time experience of individuals, but must be an invariable and common time for all individuals, on the basis of which alone cooperation in economic and social activity is possible. What kind of parameter is time, and why is it so crucial to our understanding of Jewish life in the Holocaust? The measurement of time and reference to its regular motion within a calendar or formative historical events is an essential element in a new field of research called the sociology of time. One of the most influential researchers in this field, Eviatar Zrubavel, explained the process that caused people to repeatedly recount a fixed order of events and the exact time and remember the events together. This process is based on a synthesis of rotation of flows in nature, the seasons, the celestial movement, etc., and the social need to act in a coordination with the parts of the collective and the nature. In other words, the cycle of time with its determining circularity is a fundamental element of what the sociologist Norbert Elias called the civilization process for the existence of any social framework. The event fixed in time, most of which were created layer upon layer during the collective's shared history, make the necessary synchronization of individuals and the social groups to which they belong. He called this active process timing. The regulation of time that takes the experience of time part of the self of the various individuals that make up society. The Jews are one of the peoples whose experience of time in their civilization process is particularly prominent. They lived as a rejected and persecuted minority for many years. Their late formation as a modern political nation happened only at the end of the 19th century with the appearance of the Zionist movement. This history guided the consistency of the flow of time. The linear and uniform flow of time was not among Jews based on political or social stability. Hence, the linear flow of time, which we have seen to be essential to the civilization process of individuals in the collective, was for the Jews based mainly on Jewish calendar and its sanctified holidays and historical events. Some are what we call mid-deoraita, in Aramaic from biblical origin, and other refer to fundamental historical events whose reference in the calendar contributed to the creation of the cycle of the historical time, not from the deoraita, not from biblical origins. Example including Hanukkah and the destruction of the first and the second temples. Over the years, additional events, mainly tragic ones, added to the story of the Jewish martyrology and became part of the Jewish cycle of time. The written and order of time flow, as it is experienced in the present, based on memory and understanding, is central to the individual's acquaintance with the current life and ability to interpret the future. The psychologist Eugen Minkowski defined this condition as experience time, when it has two states, one relating to activity and the other to anticipation. The individual in a particular life reality, this is activity, turns in every given situation to the future to feel that he controls the events and can control his existential situation. However, while addressing the future is based on passivity and lack of accurate orientation regarding one's ability to regulate it, the individual becomes passive and is filled with feeling of helpless, embarrassment, and confusion. One of the most well-known examples of such a reality that affected almost the entire European society was the Great War. Tens of millions were caught in a passive, endless waiting and dealing with the horrors of death in the trenches, hunger, economic distress, and the incomprehensible numbers of victims. The experience time was far from an active experience of the ability to plan the future that can be measured and anticipated. The war that broke out in 1939, the occupation of Poland, and the persecution of the Jews fractured the familiar experienced time. It crushed the old reference to the flow of time as was experienced until September 1939. To understand this break's meaning, we must comprehend the importance of experienced time that the Jews shared from the beginning of the German occupation until the arrival of the final destruction in 1942. In the summer of 1940, even before the ghetto was sealed, the underground Zionist Halutzi movement, Dror, published a literary historical anthology, Pain und Gvura, Agony and Heroism. The anthology included literary chapters from influential mainly Yiddish and Hebrew writers and poets like Shalom Ash, Haim Nachman Bialik, Shaul Chernichovsky, Yitzhak Lamdan, Yosef Haim Brenner, Isaac Leib Peretz Markish, Alter Dorianov, and intellectual chronicles and historians like Nathan Hanover, Hadaham, Heinrich Gretz, Shimon Dubner, Dubnow and others. The anthology was quite eclectic. It was edited by one of the movement's central activists, Elisha Eliyahu Gutkowski. His goal was to provide the movement members with a collection of sources and texts they could use in the movement's educational activity, which went underground at the beginning of the occupation. Nevertheless, in the anthology's preface, one can see an effort to deal with the unknown, threatening experience time in which Polish Jews began to live. Gutkowski managed to identify the characteristics of the Jews' current persecution compared to the past. In all places, where we have been living for generations in many occupations, in many countries in Europe, our enemies are doing everything they can to destroy us spiritually and physically. However, this assertion does not bring Gutkowski new historical insights. In fact, this remained unfamiliar to him when he refers to the Jewish people's present and future, because immediately afterwards he stated that, and I quote, "The darkest days of the new Middle Ages have come upon us with all the accessories of its angels of destruction, but in new and sophisticated clothing of the 20th century. The same nightmares of Middle Ages burst into our public life. Hermetically locked ghettos for Jews, the yellow patch on the front and back, special Jewish hallmarks, ribbons on the sleeve, and mass murder." Did Gutkowski understand the meaning of the new time with that understanding establish expressions of the future? Did he understand the meaning of the Nazification of the time, and its consequences for contemporary Jewish existence? So, what is precisely the Nazification of time? Scholars have long noted Nazism's challenge to the pace of life and timekeeping of German society as it was in the Weimar Republic. The Nazis created new dimensions of time that were designed according to the Nazi worldview, the Weltanschauung. Their goal was to create a new historical framework and society that would be active in history for a long time, as expressed in their slogan, "The Thousand Years Reich." Das Tausendjährige Reich. While the Nazis rejected the powerless time that was manifested, for example, in the trench warfare experienced in the Great War, Gutkowski suggested that the Jewish experience depended on the heritage designed to preserve what Nazification of time threatened to destroy. I quote, we are an ancient nation, cultural nation with a rich culture and spiritual heritage. We cannot and we do not want to be destroyed. After all, during our 3,000 years historical existence, countless difficult hours have passed us, and perhaps even more difficult than the current one. And we continue to exist again the anger and the fury of our enemies and oppressions. In his book, The Culture of Time and Space, Stefan Kern referred to the need of many in the 20th century, given the multiple crises of the time, to look back to the past and lean on familiar events in the face of the difficulties and instability of the period. For many, relying on the past was a source of anchor and meaning as things emerge so clearly in what Gutkowski writes. Chaim Aaron Kaplan deals countless times in his writing with the meaning of time. In one of the most poignant accounts he wrote in his diary in January 1940, historical events capture the entire imagination only after their time. Through long periods and the flow of generation, they receive their true character. When space and time are soon nothing more than passing occurrence, and it will not make an impression. A historical event, like a colored picture, needs perspective. Humans who have been privileged to witness great events nevertheless deal with everyday needs, with small things and actions that fix individual lives and adapt them to the needs of the present moment. Perhaps this is the secret of life and eternity. A significant aspect of Jewish life during the Holocaust that has hardly been studied in depth is the historical consciousness of the Jews at the time. Their beliefs, decrypted their life and the future, the symbols they used to explain the present, how reality was perceived, how they gave meaning to themselves and the world where they lived, how their identity changed. Oskar Rosenfeld, a Jew from Vienna, who was deported to Łódź ghetto in November 1941, wrote in his diary on December 1st, 1943, the changes in intellectual and economic society and economic social functions brought with them a change in the most obvious concepts. Ideas that until now were taken for granted by Europeans everywhere underwent a complete transformation. What is that complete transformation that time has caused? What clear and understandable concept underwent such a transformation? As mentioned, the Nazification of the time aspired to make its mark, among other things, on the invention of a different year cycle, the holidays and the special days, challenging the cycle of time that existed in previous periods. We can find a similar reference in the Jewish response to this goal. The Jewish response to the Nazification of time transformed Jewish time into a new reality of life. One example is, a meaningful example, I think, is in one of Rabbi Shimon Huberband, who wrote in his records. There are shoot, question and answer, for specific days of the war. 7 days of mourning for relatives who died or were killed in the war. Saying Kaddish, a day of remembrance and burial. If the Seder is to be held on a night of Passover without four cups. Unleavened matzah. If it is allowed to use grapes, wine without sugar. On the eating permit for the sick and weak on Yom Kippur. Or sick people for whom it is permissible, to desecrate the Shabbat, or no kosher meat for the sick and weak, because kosher meat is difficult to obtain and it also costs much money. The Israeli historian Elisheva Kalabach emphasized the centrality of the Jewish calendar in the world of Ashkenazi Jews in early modern Europe, especially during the period of persecution and restrictions. connecting to the fixed Jewish time granted security and stability in a reality where the outside world threatened existence. The holidays and religious custom were a central tool in mnemonic socialization. It has the ability to synchronize between the customs of the past and the reality of life in present. It is precisely what Huberman described to us. Referring to his description from the perspective of cultural history give essential meaning to the Jews' confrontation with Nazification of time. After all, Nazism not only sought to shape a new German time in its spirit, in the spirit of the Nazi ideology. In the Nazi time, any Jewish time cycle could not exist. Huberman showed us that the Jews understood this well. Instead of the traditional Jewish time circle that collapsed, they faced the creation of an alternative time circle that would bypass the Nazification of time imposed on them. It was long, complex, and many difficulty process that lost meaning at the arrival of the final solution. Researchers dealing with the meaning of time in modern life have not faced the question of time in the reality where time no longer exists. Because if time, as suggested by Norbert Elias, is an integral part of civilization process, what meaning does it have when this process ceases to exist? When we study Jewish responses to the deportation in 1942, 1943, we are often confounded by the disconnect between what they write and their conclusions from it. Hence, we must consider the individual's essential inability to internalize that the known routine of time has ended, no longer exists, and the civilization process has terminated. Kaplan, again, expressed this many times in his diary entries in spring-summer 1942, since the arrival of the news about deportation from the Lublin area. On June 17, 1942, he wrote, "Nazism condemned us to death. In its pride and stupidity, it does not conceal it. On the contrary, it declares and proclaims that this is a deceived verdict that will not return void. Moreover, it is clear to us, if it can, it will carry out directive. And yes, we are waiting to die. We are waiting to die. However, if we live, we need all necessities of life, not only the dead forgotten from the heart, but even death in general is also forgotten. There is no life without motion, without aspiration, and without passion. And when you pump and amends in your head and yourself in all the silliness of life, this is then rejected in the face of life. Even if the inhabitants of the ghetto are condemned to death, they want to enjoy life as long as their souls are still inside them. However, the inmates of the ghetto are limited in their ability to create the pleasure that their souls can consume. And like the Nazi way, We use substitutes. Human passion cannot be imprisoned." End of quote. In his profound insights, Kaplan correctly understands the fate awaiting for the Jews under the Nazi rule. Nevertheless, in his word, he also explained the stubborn defense of the Jews against accepting this fate. He described the stubborn departure of the Jews against their submission to the Nazi area that the occupiers tried to impose on them. The control over time presents not only the ideology and the significant landmarks of a regime, because any regime wants to influence the cycle of time of the society. Every revolutionary regime in modern time tried to impose its principle on the calendar and time. We can count it, it was done by Oliver Cromwell, for instance, revolutionary regime in England in the 17th century, the revolutionary republican regime in France during the French Revolution, the Bolshevik regime in Russia after the revolution, and of course, the Nazi regime in Germany after 1933. The Jews' ability to stop, to delay the Nazification of time was of course impossible. However, as we saw in Huberband, when the cycle of time is about to end, Kaplan states, like the Nazi way, we use substitutes. We use substitutes. The Jews were waiting for the final German verdict, but continued pushing the end forward, striking to the cycle of time as if death was not predicted, and attaching to the desire for life. We discussed the vision of time in Jewish life during two periods, from the outbreak of the war and concentrations in the ghettos, and when deportation to the death camps began in Poland in 1942. News about the deportation reached and accumulated in the Warsaw Ghetto and other places, and we know it. If we want to understand it epistemologically, the Jews knew that their time was counted. However, they continued their life routine under the threatening shadow of understanding that many Jewish communities were being whipped out of all over occupied Poland. But then arrived the last stage, which is most difficult to analyze due to the limitations of sources, and this is the stage of displacement and deportation. How Jews understand the cycle of time from the moment of the concentration to the deportation, the transport until reaching the final destination, the extermination camp. On December 16, 1942, an anonymous Jew from Płońsk wrote a note and threw it from the train track taking the deportees to Auschwitz. And I quote, "Please drop the note into the nearest mailbox. It is morning now. We are in the wagon with the Holy Family. We are leaving with the last load. Płońsk is cleansed of Jews. Please enter the bus family Niska 6 in Warsaw and say hello." On the same day, from the same train, another Jew named David from Legionovo, who was in Płońsk at the time of the deportation, threw a note with the words in similar vein. After writing the address of his relatives in Warsaw Ghetto, to whom he asked to deliver the note on Nalewski Street, he writes, "Today we left Płońsk. Our whole family and all the Jews went. Be aware that we are getting to a wedding, a code name for extermination. Goodbye." One of the most difficult to contain documents is a note found fastened to a hand of a baby in Wukov after the deportation. His deported mother wrote, "Merciful people, save the child. God will reward you. Do not hand the child over the murderers. Everything will be paid for. He has in Wukov two properties, and everything will be paid for. Have mercy on the unfortunate child." This is what a mother asked who could not do elsewhere. The suffering mother, HP. In another farewell letter from Płońsk also, Sala writes her daughter, Rozinka, who lived in hiding. "You see, we thought we would stay until Friday, but unfortunately this is our last day. The attempts to get through to you were unsuccessful, and there is no time for that now. In this situation, one must compromise and accept everything with love. Yes, my only one, only God knows if we will see each other again. After all, we live in the hope that we will. We are already going out tomorrow into the unknown. Fully aware and at peace. If we descend to live, it's all good. And if not, too bad. We have already lost the dearest, and most importantly, there is nothing to console. Our only wish was to see you, our only one, our dearest. Be blessed, our dearest of all. I know it will be difficult for you to admit that you have already lost us, but what can we do? This is what fate wants, and this is how it must be. I say goodbye to you. I embrace you tightly to my heart. I hope we will see each other again. I love you with all my heart and miss you." Judaism sees death as a discouraging and demoralizing event that should be avoided, postponed, and delayed if possible. For example, the Bible tells us that Moses and King David sought to postpone their death to such an extent that the angel of death, who carries out the divine sentence, had to trick them to fulfill his mission. When we examine these hard-to-read documentations left behind by Jews who were on the way to their death, it seemed that they realized that the cycle of time had stopped and they could no longer postpone the end. They wanted to try to delay it differently. If they cannot postpone the end, they want to delay it differently. They try to continue the experienced time. I'm using this phrase again, the experienced time. If not in a physical sense, like escaping from the train, which very few could do, then at least in the metaphorical, symbolic meaning, even though they no longer controlled it. They wrote a farewell letter, greeting to their loved ones, expressed acceptance of the fate decreed on them, and emphasized that the last thing they wanted was for their loved one to continue with their lives and be saved, or even leave behind their child in the hope that honorable people would save him. To sum up, There are widely variety of standard ways people measure the passage of time. Traditionally, the Jews tended to mark the transition in time while relying on the Jewish holidays and memorable days, as they also existed in other cultures. Standard time measuring required a clock or calendar. However, our reference to time measure is often based on milestones anchored either in clock time or in the Gregorian or Jewish calendar. If it is on the level of individual, our reference to time based on events etched in the memory of as significant to our lives. The year my daughter was born, when I lived in New York, a year after my grandson was born, etc. At a collective and national level, the reference is to be founding in an historical events, when the war ended, when we joined the European Union, so on, so forth. Endless examples could be given. The Nazi regime and its effort to Nazify time presented the Jews with a reality in which the traditional measuring of time marking, faced an existential danger. The German sociologist Helmut Rosa pointed out in his studies a situation in which people or society experience a slowdown in their life experience either by choice or by external necessity. On a personal level, this can be due to illness or personal crisis, and on a national level, due to historical circumstances such as war, natural disaster, or severe economic crisis. He defined this slowdown as time standing still. Those who are in a situation where time seems to stand still face desynchronization against the social or historical time of their lifetime. They are unable to adapt to the accelerate pace of social time and can consequently deteriorate into a state of embarrassment, helplessness, or apathy. Rosa's analysis explained well Jewish struggle against the German occupation of Poland with the issue of time. The Jews went through a double desynchronization. They were excluded from the circle of life of the society in which they lived before the war, with the annihilation of the Polish state and their imprisonment and isolated in the ghetto. Poland was, with all the problems and difficulties, tensions, their nation state. It no longer existed, and the Germans forced an actual physical separation of them from the connection with the Polish society. The Nazi racist ideology made them ostracized from the national living environment in which they lived, not only in the physical sense, but in the social sense as well. Confinement in the ghettos cut them off from the circle of Jewish life and led to a complete atomization of the Jewish society. This is how Jewish life became time standing still. We can state that Nazification time and space was a powerful oppressive tool in the German efforts to eliminate Jewish life, a tool that until today has received only little research attention. However, despite all this, until the stage when they stood face to face with death, the Jews continued to struggle with the time standing still. We saw it in the first period of war and during the changes in 1942, when they lived under the shadow of the extermination news. Nevertheless, when time terminated and death was inevitable and final, consciousness was utterly different. Circumstances in which no human being can live defined the new form of time. Two diarists, far from each other in place, culture, and personal background, described it in their writings. Viktor Klemperer, the Jewish intellectual from Dresden, who was banned in July 23, 1941, and imprisoned for 8 days, described it in his diary, the experience of time in a reality when he was isolated and out of touch with his world and life. And I quote, "When the first night had begun for me in bright daylight, the despair which had until then been repressed rose up. Now I had already been here for an endless time, a truly endless time. This is something that cannot be described. One can convoy what happened, the last event, the last thought, but endless consists consists in what lies between in a simple feeling of being in a cage of emptiness and nothingness. So endless, emptiness and nothingness. Of the four steps to the window and the four steps to the door. Zalman Gadovsky, the Sonderkommando prisoner from Auschwitz, in one of the most moving entries he wrote in his diary Scramp called Moonlight, expressed his sense of endlessness when he stood in the face of the mass extermination in Auschwitz. He defies the moon that continues to shine its light on the world of death ruled by the doom. He defies the moonlight, the creator of the world order, defies all history. Moon, gather your light together. Come here with your splendor and charm. Stay standing here forever with your spells, with your irritations. And then you will dress in black clothes for a walk across the bleak, tragic horizon. And in sorrow and grief, you wrap the sky and the stars that your kingdom will float in sorrow. Let black clouds will cover the sky forever. Let only one light fall on the world. Only one more ray for them. A ray for the victims of my people. Come here, you moon. Stay standing here forever. Sit on the swearing stone at the grave of my people and at least shed a tear for them because there is no one left. There is no one left to cry, to mourn for them. We saw that Norbert Elias defined timing as a synthesis based on the cycle of nature, phenomena, cosmic bodies, seasons, and the need for the individual to act within time in full coordination with nature. Gradovsky, who understands the meaning of the Nazi extermination, challenges these definitions. There is no more coordination because timing ends. The time ends. It is no longer a parameter because there is no more existence. Thus, he turns to the heavenly bodies to fulfill a new function in time and be a tombstone for the terrible Jewish catastrophe. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your inspiring and thought-provoking lecture. And now I would like to encourage you, if you have any questions, to Professor Blattman. Czy są jakieś pytania? Mamy teraz jeszcze chwilę na ich zadawanie. Ktoś musi być pierwszy.
I have a question. What was the postal service like for Jews in the ghetto from the messages that were thrown from the trains?
Well, these messages actually has not arrived in the ghetto. These messages was found, you know, they didn't arrive anywhere. They were found by local population and they were kept, and after the war discovered here and there, they couldn't find them in archives, some here in Jir, some in Yad Vashem, some other places. But I mean, this is not, the message was not, actually, we cannot say that there was a real purpose that this message will get somewhere. So it's kind of a last will. So they addressed it to people in the ghettos, even though they don't know, even when they throw these messages from the train, if these people are still alive. So these messages did not arrive in any ghetto. Other messages arrived, but not from the train, from other couriers who, you know, but this is a different phenomenon. This is not connected to what I was touching here.
Dobrze, jeśli nie mamy pytań, to mamy teraz przerwę 15 minut do godziny 10:30. Bardzo dziękujemy Państwu za tą pierwszą część.